about anthropology, literary journalism, and memoir. We tend to believe that the concept of literary journalism is something new, that is something kind of modern and really hip, and the reality is that it's been part of the American narrative for a long time. So if we go back to the 1800s, I'm just gonna do this just so we know that we have a background and that it's not completely new. And we're gonna go over it really quickly. I want to talk about Lafcadio Hearn because he was a really cool character for many reasons. So first of all, he was Greek. He came to America in the 1800s and he learned English here and became a very well-known writer of the time, okay? He broke many rules when he came here. One of the rules that he broke was, before I say that, he was the editor-in-chief of a very well-known newspaper of the time. I can't remember the name, but it was a big newspaper in New Orleans, okay? And then he broke the first rule, and he married an African-American woman, and miscegenation was considered illegal. So this interracial marriage marked the end of his career as editor-in-chief in the newspaper. So he was fired for marrying a black woman, and he was given just a little job in a lesser newspaper somewhere else, and his job was to write obituaries.
Oh, my God.
And yeah, that was a serious demotion. But this is what's so interesting about these little turns that life takes. He was writing the obituaries when a man by the name of Jean Montanet died. And Jean Montanet was such a cool character in New Orleans that some people knew him as Jean Lafiselle, or Jean Latanier, or Jean Racine, or Jean Riri, or Jean Macaque, or Jean Bayou, or Voodoo John, or Bayou John, or Dr. John. And he was the last voodoo high priest in New Orleans. And it was the last one, and probably the one that captured the most attention in New Orleans because he had a lot of power over the African American population. He was feared, revered, there was a lot of mystery around him. When he died, public school was becoming more prevalent and public standard education and occultism didn't go hand in hand. So that was pretty much the end of occultism out of Africa as it was in the beginning of public school. So when the guy died, rather than writing just a simple obituary, he just went all out. And what he did was he presented a beautiful portrayal of African population, occultism, witches and wizards straight out of Africa, all that they had brought from the African tradition and incorporated into their lives in the States. It was a long essay. You can find it, it's free online, and it's called The Last of the Voodoos. It's OU for some strange reason. So he had already married a black woman. He had already been fired. He wrote this, which was very well received. People read about it and thought like, oh, this is not just such and such died and he survived by this and this. It was a long story of traditions and witchcraft, and it was just a different way to look at the African population of the moment in New Orleans. Then, because he was married to a black woman and he was so immersed in the black world of New Orleans, he did a lot of exploration. He did anthropology without doing anthropology. He just went around observing, documented, reporting, and he wrote something called Levy Life, which was just another exploration of the black American subculture in New Orleans. It was just out of the Civil War, and nobody had explored this process of acculturation. What was happening to the black population now after the Civil War? So he just kind of captured how they were acculturated, how they were trading traditions, the black ones that they had brought from Africa for the mainstream ones so that it could be incorporated into the culture. And then he just got the hang of it, and I said, I'm going to go a little bit farther, and I'm going to get into linguistics. And what he did with the Voices of Dawn is that he was probably the first one to explore the cadences of the Creole language of the Hopis in New Orleans. So nobody had done it, and suddenly there is music in what they, in the way they speak, the way they sell their goods, and it is also free online. You can just type Voices of Dawn and it will come up, right? So we're talking about mid to late 1800s. And then, of course, we have Mark Twain, which did the same thing, or who did the same thing without calling it anthropology, literary journalism, and memoir, right? So Mark Twain did a trilogy that has largely considered travel writing, but it's actually a combination of travel writing and memoir and anthropology. Life on the Mississippi, that goes without saying, is just, it captures the life of the people living up and down the Mississippi. Innocence Abroad and Roughing It, those two have been considered hardcore Mark Twain's travel writing, when reality is a combination of anthropology, memoir, because he writes about what he sees, what he lives, and at the same time, it portrays the communities that he goes across and explores. And of course, when Mark Twain went to central and the southern part of Europe, he wrote all his travels in A Tramp Abroad. And The Tramp Abroad is pure anthropology. It's a very detailed account of European communities and cultures through all the countries that he visits, right? So this concept has been around for a long time. And then I want to talk about this guy, Lincoln Stephens, because what he did just kind of sealed the deal. It's like we have literary journalism in America, and this guy was the one that called it that way. So he is the editor of the New York Commercial Advertisers in the 1890s, and there is a murder in town. So he calls his favorite writer, and he says this. Okay. There is a report that a man has murdered his wife, a rather bloody act of crime. I do believe there is a story in it. That man loved that woman well enough once to marry her, and now he has hated her enough to cut her all to pieces. If you can find out just what happened between the wedding and the murder, you will have a novel for yourself and a piece of news for the newspaper. And what he did, he just sanctioned this thing. It's just something happened, a crime has been committed, but there is more than a crime, there is a book there. You go write the book and give me the little juice that I need for the newspaper. And what he was doing in giving the writer that instruction is he was bridging journalism with memoir, right? And from then on, people just got the hang of it, like, all right, there's something happened, and there is more than that. So it's not just a piece of news, it's a whole story behind the headline, right? And then, of course, if we move 50 years forward in time, when we get to 1954 in Kansas, there was a quadruple murder. I don't know if you remember, it was four members of the Clutter family were murdered, and Truman Capote was really intrigued by what had happened. So he went to Kansas with Harper Lee, and the both of them investigated the murders. Eventually, the guys were killed, I mean, were captured and executed, and Truman Capote was there through the whole time doing journalism. So far, he's been a writer. Now he's incorporating journalism. He went there to Kansas. He interviewed the investigators, the detectives, the family, and then he mixed that with the memoir genre, and he produced In Cold Blood. And what's so admirable about what he did is that we end up feeling empathy for the murders.
Thank you.
We know the guy so intimately, and there is a part of us that we kind of understand why they did what they did. So this being able to move from the writer to the journalist and back into the writer, wrap it all in a package, give it to you, and make you feel something, that was quite unique. And that's what Truman Capote did with Cold Blood. When In Cold Blood was published, it became a hit. No one has done or had done anything like that before. People were just interested in the gore and interested in all the empathy that was arousing, and people were just taken by the language, and Truman Capote just did pretty much anything he wanted with the reader, okay? It was, or it has been, the second largest, or hold on a second, what is this, the second largest sale, what is the one I'm trying to say? The second highest sales after Helter Skelter. Mm-hmm. So Helter Skelter was the true crime that so far it has been the largest, seller. And then Cold Blood. Let's see. In the end, we can move to something that we are very familiar with, which is magical realism. And magical realism, you might be wondering, what does that have to do with journalism and memoir? It's magical realism, so it can't be anyone's memoirs, right? But if you look at Gabriel Garcia Marquez and what he did, he was a journalist. That's what he did. He worked for a newspaper, and his job was to go out and look for stories, right? When he decided to start writing fiction, I watched him giving an interview, and he said that it was just out of laziness, that he just couldn't be bothered to cross-check and cross-reference and fact-check and say, well, I know a crime was committed, but wouldn't it be great if she was this, you know, she had magical powers or whatever. So he pretty much made up stories based on true facts. But he was a journalist, and what he did was a beautiful, beautiful mixture of journalism, fiction, and memoir. Mm-hmm. And in the process of doing so, he was also introducing Colombian culture to the world. Mm-hmm. So the byproduct of this mixture is anthropology. The world knew where Colombia was, and the world knew a lot about what we eat, the way we dance, our modisms, our little Colombianisms, because of Gabriel Garcia Marquez had the chops that required to put everything in the pot and deliver a nice soup, so everyone had a taste of Colombia through Gabriel Garcia Marquez, right? So it's not a concept that is contemporary, it's not new. It's been at least in the American narrative from the 1800s and probably before, but the 1800s, these people here are the ones that we have on the record as the first ones to do it or to talk about it. Now, we're gonna be talking about looking for Esperanza and how we end up marrying all these different elements into a happy relationship. And in order for me to tell you about looking for Esperanza, I need to take you to Kuwait. So let's say that looking for Esperanza is the final destination, but there is a journey, right? So there is a journey. What I want to do at the moment is, I think she doesn't like my voice. She's tired. So I just want you to do the journey with me. I'm going to condense a lot of information, and it will make sense. You know, the first 5 minutes you will go like, oh, what does that have to do with looking for Esperanza? A lot. It's just, it will make sense. So bear with me, let's stay focused, because then you will understand why you have that book in your hands. I lived in Kuwait in between wars. I lived there after the first Gulf War and before the second one. That is 1996 to 2000. Three things made me write about social justice and memoir and anthropology. I was an anthropologist when I moved to Kuwait, and I had been accepted into UCLA as a PhD candidate in dance ethnography. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to explore cultures through dance, right? That's what I was doing with the Eskimos, with the Yupik in Alaska, and that's what I wanted to do there. Big mistake. I wanted to do belly dance studies in Kuwait. And Kuwaitis don't dance belly dance. It's forbidden. Mm-hmm. Right? So that was the first one to go. I couldn't do that professionally. I couldn't do it. So I have a little stint as a DJ. Is that funny? And one of the sheikhas knew that I was an anthropologist, and apparently I was the only anthropologist in Kuwait. So I heard that you're interested in music and in dance and blah, blah, blah. Would you like to have an hour on the radio? Yeah. So, and I had a vast collection of world music. So I prepared the shows, and it was a really nice experience. It was an hour of pygmy chants and cha-cha-chas and mambos and Brazilian music and hakas and so on and so forth. I would explain the ethnic groups, the countries, the history. It was a really, really good experience. Until I found out that that hour that I was on was the hour that everyone in Kuwait switched the radio off. It was a flop. Nobody was interested in international music. They wanted Britney Spears. They wanted Spice Girls. That was hot. Pygmy chants, excuse me. So that didn't work. I am not British. I am not American, although I have an American passport. And I couldn't quite fit in any group in Kuwait. There are lots of British, lots of Americans, and I just couldn't find my place. And it was very disconcerting just trying to find a community to belong to. That's why I was so desperately looking for a job. Then eventually, I got into touch with the curator of the museum, and I said, I have a plan about a collection of oral history. Lots of Bedouins had left the desert, and lots of Bedouin traditions were, being lost. And I volunteered to collect oral history. And we exchanged emails, and it was fantastic. The guy was all for it. So we made an appointment, I showed up, and then he realized that Dr. Paramo was a woman, and he was not too thrilled. So while I signed my emails as Dr. Paramo, he was really cool. And then when he found out that Dr. Paramo was a woman, he wasn't too cool about it. He said that, well, the Bedouins are not going to talk to women, and, you know, the guys will not talk to me, and so on and so forth. That didn't happen either. Someone was opening a school for girls and offered me a job as a teacher. You know, I'm not a teacher. I don't have, a license to teach. It's all right. It's in Kuwait. You can do anything you want. Speak Spanish, yes. I'm gonna be teaching Spanish. You're a petroleum engineer, right? Yeah. Oh, can you teach earth sciences? Sure. So I'm teaching earth sciences. I know how to say oui and French, so I was teaching French. It was easy. I ended up teaching a lot of things to a group of very wealthy Kuwaiti girls. And because I was a woman, and I have a group of women, or young women in my class, I had access to the women in their families. And I started to mix work with work. I was a teacher, but I was an anthropologist too. When we have the meetings with the parents, the mothers would come, all covered. They would give me a piece of their lives, and I started to learn a lot about what it meant to be a woman in Kuwait. Right? So far, so good?
Yeah.
So it started to mix my personal life with anthropology. I need to make a parenthesis here and to add that when I moved to Kuwait, my marriage was in shambles. It was not working. But we thought that it was Alaska that was killing the marriage. It was not him, it was not me, it was Alaska. And Kuwait was going to restore everything that we had lost, Kuwait. So we moved to Kuwait thinking that this new country was gonna breathe life into our relationship, and it didn't. What happened was that I fell in love with another man, and that I had an affair in a Muslim country that is about this tiny, where everybody knows everyone, where I was risking being sent to jail and lose my girl. but I carried on with the affair, right? When I started to teach the girls, we just hit it off. I was their favorite teacher, and it was just a great relationship, great, fantastic relationship. I had a great rapport with the girls. I was young, I was fit, I was hip, I was just the same color skin, I was the same height, I was... We were like sisters. It was fantastic, right? They didn't have the right to vote. And because we were so close and we had this great relationship, I pushed the issue. It is important that you fight for the right to vote, right? You will be able to do this and to do that. And they're all fired up. They really wanted to go out and do politics. So because we were out of a war, and the Americans are so keen on pushing their notions of democracy and liberation, all that, there were lots of women in Kuwait giving talks about the women liberation movement and the right to vote and all that. So I invited one into the classroom, right? We rehearsed the whole thing, who was gonna ask what, and they were gonna make me look amazing. The woman came and she was beautiful and she was just really empathetic and sympathetic and everything. And she finished and I said, okay, do we have any questions? Okay, how about you? You know, like, rehearsed last night?
Nothing.
There was nothing, just blank stares, no emotion. So I escorted the woman out, I apologized, came back to the classroom and said, what happened? We don't want the right to vote. Why? And then they gave me all the reasons. Because when a woman becomes a public figure, that woman becomes the subject of scrutiny. We don't want that. We don't want to be scrutinized. We don't want anyone looking at the shoes and wondering how much we pay for a shoe, for a pair of shoes. We don't want to sit at a table with men looking at our bodies. We don't want to leave our kids behind at home because we have a meeting with men. You know, decent women don't go out and share the table with other men. They gave me all these reasons. And because without the right to vote, they had more than any American woman in their eyes. We have fathers who give us everything that we want. We have husbands who look after us. We have Paris and London just around the corner, and we can go and buy anything we want. What is it that we gain with the right to vote? We already have it all. And I couldn't quite figure out the change of heart. Why? Why 2 days ago we were so like, yeah, let's change the world, let's set Kuwait on fire. And now, I found out later that the day before, one of the students had seen me with my lover. And they knew he wasn't my husband. And that was it. That was the end of the honeymoon. And as a woman, as a teacher, as an anthropologist, I also had to understand that all this great rapport that I had with them was not because I was a really cool teacher. It was because I fulfilled a role in their lives. They had an idea of an ideal teacher, and I was that. The moment I fell short of fulfilling that ideal, they just dropped me off the pedestal and they just forget it. We were no longer friends. And it was a very difficult relationship from then on. That's anthropology and that's memoir. I cannot separate one from the other because my role as an anthropologist is to explain why people do what they do. And when they did that to me, I had to wear my anthropologist hat and try to understand why they had done it. And I understood the reason, right? Let's move back to my academic life. I was a PhD candidate in international relations and I had to choose my dissertation topic. Kuwait is highly hierarchical. There's the rich, and there's the poor, and there's nothing in between. So for me as an anthropologist, it was very palpable, the social injustice and inequality in Kuwait. If you drive outside Kuwait, you start seeing what you see when you go looking for immigrants, like the ones that you read about in Looking for Esperanza. Very abandoned, neglected enclaves on the outskirts of the city. No AC, no fire extinguishers, no police, no hospital. People living in squalor and in complete neglect in the richest country in the world. Those were Indian women working in Kuwait as maids. So I decided to work with them as the topic of my dissertation. I wanted to do an evaluation of the quality of life. So there are certain parameters and certain models that you can use to evaluate people's quality of life. Nobody had done that before there, so I had to design my own, blah, blah, blah. You cannot enter the work camps. That's off limits to everyone. I had to find my way into the work camps to do my job as an anthropologist. So there is a group of charismatic women, American charismatic women spreading the gospel in Kuwait, doing proselytism, which is illegal in Kuwait, but doing it nonetheless, right? One of them, I didn't know, was my friend, and she was also a charismatic sister, and she used to visit the work camps with other charismatics. So, no, I'm sorry, not charismatics, Pentecostals. So she said, sure, we go there because we are in the process of spreading the gospel, and we go there and we bring toiletries and Bibles and so on and so forth. If you want to come along, you're welcome. I went with them, and I just realized that their interests and mine were very different. We had a moment, probably the third or fourth visit. You have to realize this is a group of women who are ill. We are at almost 125 degrees. People living on top of each other, cockroach infested accommodation, no ACs, no emergency exits. These women had not been paid, or they had been paid three times in a year. They were not allowed to leave the country, because once you enter Kuwait or any Gulf country, you cannot leave the country for 2 years. Your passport is confiscated upon arrival. Some of them were converted without their knowledge as soon as they arrived. It's like, your name is Sahih, and now you are Fatima. And she doesn't speak English, she doesn't speak Arabic, she speaks Malayalam, the language that she comes with from India, and lots of things have done to her identity upon arrival. The confiscation of the passport is a big one, right? It still does, in Kuwait and where I live. They're in the process of changing that. They're ill, they are hungry, they haven't been paid, they are mute, they're invisible, and here we have a group of well-fed American Pentecostals given Bibles in English. Mm-hmm. And more interestingly, you have the Indian women dying to get their hands on the shiny Bible. Mm-hmm. Because it's an American thing. It was like a McDonald's, mm-hmm. right? It wasn't the content, because they couldn't understand English. It was shiny and the leather cover, and it had this cross, which is for them, Jesus was just another god in the pantheon. So you have Ganesh and Krishna and Shiva and then Jesus, right? All of them just part of the same pantheon. The day that I decided that I couldn't go back with the Pentecostal sisters, they started to speak in tongues. And I have never, ever seen anything like that in my life, right? I was frightened. I thought I was going to get eaten. I do not understand the concept. I'm not familiar enough with the religion to understand what happens. All I know is that they started to speak in tongues, and sure enough, after they did, some of the Indian women who had recently been converted started to speak in tongues too. The anthropologist just kick in. I'm taking notes. I'm scared, but I'm reporting everything that I see. then one woman apparently is not speaking tongues. She's speaking something else. So all the Pentecostal sisters come, oh, that's not the Holy Spirit. We need to do something. There is something evil on her, in her, and they start patting her. And I'm just terrified because she is almost like having a fit on the floor. She's shouting things, and these women are patting her all over, and then they found out why she was speaking the language of the devil. She had an om, you know the om symbol? She had an om, which according to the sisters was the proof that she was not a real Christian, and that, thank you, and that needed to be removed. That was snatched off, it was thrown out of the window, and everyone is excited, they're sweating, they're kind of dancing, or doing all this really intense stuff, and then they just left. And I just could not believe that, I mean, oh, and they're placing hands. There was a woman with a tumor in the stomach, and she was in a lot of pain, and everyone is placing hands. I do not, I'm not going to enter into a discernation of whether or not that works. All I know is that a woman had a tumor in her stomach, that she was in a lot of pain, and that I think she needed a hospital, that she needed a physician. And, but the sisters did what they had to do, and they left. And they left the women in such a state. It felt like abandonment. You know, that you came, you aroused them, you make them feel stuff, and then you leave them. Something just didn't gel, and I never went back with them. So from then on, I started to go back on myself, and I worked with them for 2 years. For 2 years, every weekend, I went there and documented, reported their lives. Whether or not they had been paid, whether or not this one was sick, and so on and so forth. And that was my dissertation. Because we were out of a Gulf War, Amnesty International was in Kuwait. And they heard about the research that I was doing. So I was approached and said, well, we know that you're doing a little bit of social justice and some reporting in the work camps. Would you like to share the results with us? Sure, Amnesty International. Mm-hmm. So I gave him my dissertation. They looked at it and I said, listen, this is a lot of science. It's a lot of hard data. This doesn't tell us anything. You need to transform all this data into something that we can understand. And that is where anthropology and all the literature and all the journalism that I have been doing had to be mixed with memoir. I had to sit down and rewrite all this hard data into something that was a soft narrative, that was inviting, that was that brought upon awareness and something that tapped on the reader's wealth of empathy, which I couldn't do with social science, right? So good, so far, so good? Yeah, yeah, all right. In Kuwait, we were assigned a huge house. It was gigantic, and because I worked full time, I couldn't look after the house myself. So I hired an Indian woman to come and help me with cleaning the house twice a week. She didn't come one day, not a big deal. The second day that she was supposed to come, she didn't come. I got worried, I called her. And she sounded very agitated, and he said, well, what is it, Lucy? Why are you ill? And all she said is, I have chocolate water running down my legs. It had been raining a lot. So I thought maybe her apartment was flooded. And I asked her, I said, the rain? And no, madame, just chocolate water, chocolate water. So I couldn't understand, I just stay there where you are, and I'll go and see. You know, maybe I need a plumber or something like that. When I got there, sure enough, she had chocolate water running down her legs. The stench was unbelievable. She was sweaty, feverish. She said, well, what happened to you? She collapsed. She passed out. Put her in the car, took her to a hospital. Now, another major parenthesis. She's Indian, and I look Indian in Kuwait, which is not good news, because Indians are fourth class citizens in Kuwait, right? In the Arab world, it pays to be white, because if you're white, people know that you're a foreigner and they give you respect straight away. If you look Indian, they treat you like such, as such. And it's not a good combination. But instead of being white, I speak English, right? And I don't speak English with an Indian accent. So the moment I say, my maid is sick, everyone was like, oh, the maid is sick, let's do something. There's an American woman here in the house, right? Lots of attention. Lucy gets taken away, and a few minutes later, she is brought back by the arm, just by the arm. Here, we don't touch that woman. Why? Because she committed a crime. She just had an abortion. I didn't know that. I didn't know that. So I said, Lucy, and I said, Lucy, what happened? So she is married, or she was married. She had a baby in India, but could not afford another boy. So an Egyptian woman said, I can help you with that. Took her to her kitchen, and with a coat hanger, she performed the abortion and punctured her uterus. So by the time she noticed the chocolate water, it had, what is it called, septic?
Sepsis.
All right. So it was, she had an infection in her blood. They would not see her at the hospital. I took her from hospital to hospital. Nobody would touch her. At the third hospital, the doctor told me, she committed a crime, and you are helping her. Therefore, you are committing a crime. Both of you will go to jail. Oh, wow. This is getting serious. So I took Lucy to our doctor. My ex-husband used to work for British Petroleum, so we had our own British doctor. And I took Lucy there and said, do something. And the doctor said, I would not even look at her. Don't even think about it. I can lose my license. I go crazy, I shout, I remind the guy about the Hippocratic oath that he took, that, you know, you swore that you were going to save lives, that you were not going to discriminate. And he said, you know what, I'm going to give her antibiotics, take her home, let me make a few phone calls, and I'll get back to you tomorrow, if she makes it, which I doubted. So I take Lucy back home, I give her all the antibiotics and all that. Fingers crossed, the following day she's alive. I go back to the doctor and he says, I talked to an Egyptian doctor. He has already dealt with those things in the past. Just tell him that you have a little issue and he'll help you. I already talked to him. This is what happened. I go to the doctor, I am with Lucy, and he says, Dr. Such and Such already told me the issue. Don't worry, you're in good hands. You can leave your maid here and come with me. So I just follow him, right? And so, okay, just let me take your blood pressure. I said, no, wait, what? I am not ill. This is, I thought the doctor said that you had an issue. You know, not me, the maid. Oh, he said, I can lose my license for you, but I'm not going to lose my license over an Indian woman. It's not going to happen. What do you do? What you cannot possibly just look at what's happening from the outside. You have to be involved. You have to do something. The anthropologist, the woman, the mother, the wife, every bit of me had to do something for Lucy, right? Unfortunately, back then, I was not an American citizen yet, so I had a Colombian passport. With my Colombian passport, I could not travel to India without a visa. That would take a week. So I could not go with her to India. So the British doctor just gave her a cocktail of antibiotics and I don't know what else, and said, just put her on a plane and let's hope that she makes it. And that's exactly what I did. And I just put a little note in her purse. As soon as Lucy arrives, please let me know, this is my telephone number, you know, call collect, blah, blah, blah. That's what happened, and she made it. Back then, I still had this great relationship with my students, right? So I brought up the subject, and I knew that it was just a dangerous territory, that they were too young, and that I was giving them too much information, and I was dying to know what they had to offer. Because we were friends, right? And what they had to offer was a condemnation. No way, she needed to die. Because she killed the baby, and if she killed the baby, why would she have the right to live? And those are the moments where you have to mix memoir. I'm living there. This is the experience that I'm having, but I'm also documenting this. Again, at the same time that I'm documenting, I'm offering a next ray of the Kuwaiti culture. Not the Muslim culture, not the Arab culture, but the Kuwaiti culture. All those things just kind of intersected naturally in Kuwait. We talked about honor killings with students. Of course they have to happen. Do you know what a bad apple does to the rest of the bunch? And this is after we've been together for years, after we have talked about the right to vote, and after we have talked about how important it is to have a voice. And although they have a message already kind of engraved in, you know, as part of their lives, but what they have is their culture. The culture is very heavy. You just can't get, you can't shake it off. You can't get rid of everything that your culture feeds you. I left Kuwait. I moved to Florida with all this, with the experience of having worked with a neglected group of women, with the experience of writing all this hard scientific data into an easier to digest narrative for Amnesty International and then the anti-slavery organization in London. So I knew how to do it, but there was no book inside. What I had done just as a part of the social justice agenda, if you want to call it that way, right? When I moved out of Kuwait and I got to Florida, I was teaching at a university, and on my way to the university, I had to drive by a work camp. Lots and lots of immigrants there living just life that didn't even look like an American life. That was not, I would drive through all the trailer parks and look at them and look at the children with protruding bellies, and I would see the hunger and the need and the disease. And I said, this is not the American that I know. This is not the same country. You just drive 10 minutes to the east or 20 minutes to the north, and you have golf courses and swanky hotels. And here it is. I mean, this is the American dream. And I'm reflecting on this when I read in the newspaper about a woman named Esperanza. And the newspaper said that she had lost a baby crossing the border, and that she had tried to smuggle the dead baby into the States because she was afraid that the coyotes would force her to leave the baby behind, right? Because it's very inconvenient. It's a very dangerous, long journey. And the last thing the smugglers want is a dead baby. So she knew that, and she knew that she would be forced to leave the baby in an unmarked grave, and she just could not bear the thought of leaving the baby behind, so she just wrapped it and pretended that it was asleep until, you know, many hours passed, and the coyote said, the baby's not asleep. What's going on here? And sure enough, she had to leave the baby in an unmarked grave. She has no idea where the baby is. But the story also said that Esperanza lived in Lakeland, was the same town where I lived. And it was that aha moment, like, what? I mean, this woman lost a baby and she lives right here in Lakeland. This is, you know, a kind of middle class neighborhood. Where? Everyone is, you know, pretty middle class in Lakeland. I don't know anything about this. And I started looking for her. And I went up and down the peninsula, east to west and north to south, going from migrant park to trailer park to trailer park, of looking for a woman named Esperanza. And of course I couldn't find her because they changed their names. They adopt different personalities, they're chameleons. You know, they get sold fake IDs and they adopt that identity for 6 months, for a year. Then they move, they marry, it is impossible to trace, and they move because they are seasonal. So 1 month they are in Florida, 2 months later they're in Georgia, later they're in the Carolinas, and 6 months later they are in New Hampshire, Vermont, up there. They're very difficult to track down. And I started looking for her for many reasons. I found that she was a woman like me, an immigrant like me, a mother like me, someone with dreams like me. I just felt like I knew this woman. And I became obsessed with finding her. I just wanted to find her. And not because I was looking for the story, I just wanted to hold her. I wanted to look her in the eye. I wanted to have a drink with her. I don't know, I had no reason, it was not rational. I just wanted to find this woman, and that's exactly what I did for 18 months. After going up and down the peninsula looking for this woman, I ended up finding her just around the corner from my house. Mm-hmm. Now, there are things that are not in the book because they were not relevant when I was writing it. And now that I look back, I realize that maybe they were relevant. For instance, Esperanza was an alcoholic. And when I met her, she told me that she had been sober for a long time. And because she was sober, I was very supportive and all that. And she wasn't sober. Her kids told me. And I could smell the breath sometimes. And her behavior was a little bit erratic. And there was something, too, with one of her girls. There was Cholo, which is Mexican born in the States. And this Cholo, an older man, was very fond of the three girls, and I was not happy with the dynamics. And I do believe that Cholo was giving these girls a lot of presents in exchange for something, and I think Esperanza was well aware of that, and she was fine with it. And it was not my place to either put it in the book, because it was not relevant, or to intervene, because it's just a complicated matter. I had no proof, just a gut feeling that there was something not quite right there. Did I do literary journalism? All the time. Every time you go out and you interview, every time you ask questions, you are playing the role of journalist. You might not be one by trade, but you are one when you ask questions. You write down information, you document, you observe, you document, you report. So what's the difference between the anthropologist and the journalist? Because the anthropologist does the same thing. We go, we immerse ourselves into a culture, a subculture, we observe, we document, we report. So what's the difference? What do you think the difference is between a social scientist and a journalist?
A journalist is looking at the story, and an anthropologist is looking at the culture.
It's a scope, right? So the difference lies in the scope. We are looking at changing views, teaching people about a subculture, while the journalist is more punctual, is more contemporary. He is reporting for today's news.
But I see a problem with that, because this is within the description of how people want to categorize it. So it's like you have said, that they go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. You got to report, and then you got to make sure that it is the accurate fact of a certain culture. But I don't think it can be separated. Those two can't be separated, because it's still about a group of people. It's about how they act. It's about what makes them who they are. So
right.
I see that as a problematic, that it's just categorization. It's just thicker.
The way I like to see it is that we both do the same thing. I am not a journalist. I am an anthropologist. But I do the job of a journalist when I go out and interview. How do you feel about this? What do you eat? What kind of access to health services you have, and so on and so forth. I am doing the role of the journalist. The difference is how I report my findings back and what the aim is. As an anthropologist, I am not looking at being published by today's news, right? Or to make it to the weekly news. I am looking at changing the outlook completely or bringing awareness. So looking for Esperanza is timeless in the sense that for as long as we have undocumented women working in this country, the book is relevant. That doesn't happen with news, right? Should we take some questions now or comments, anything?
When it came to writing the report for Amnesty International, did you find that, because you started off with hard science and data, did you find that when you sort of turned it into a narrative, it sort of lessened the impact rather than just having statistics? Or do you think it helped it by turning it into a narrative?
I think it helped. I think it helped because what you want to do with that is you want to compel people to change, right? You want people's empathy, and you don't do that with numbers. So when you soften the narrative, when you take all these numbers and all the statistics and all the results and diagrams, and you turn that into a narrative, anyone can read that. Not everyone can understand the numbers and the statistics, but everyone can relate to a group of women who are being exploited. Everyone understands the concept of modern slavery. Numbers are very difficult to digest. So I think it helped. I think it helped, yeah.
How did you go about trying to find her? I mean, did you have the newspaper article, and did you just simply say, I'm looking for this woman who lost a baby? How did you get yourself into the trailers or the camps or the tent, how did you do that?
Exactly as you said, I just went, I found one trailer park, and I looked around, they looked Mexican. They could have been Salvadorian or Guatemalan, but it's like, they looked all the same from the border there. I remember that, So that's exactly what I did. The moment you park your car, everyone looks at you and think that you are children and families and that you come here or that you're La Migra. And so either think you're La Migra, nobody talks to you. Everyone goes back to the trailer park. The doors are closed, the windows are closed, and suddenly the park is empty, right? But, I'm sorry, yeah, exactly, very good. I made the mistake of driving funky sporty car into a trailer park and nobody talked to me. And then it dawned on me, like, maybe I just need to drive a truck or something that is more approachable. But that's exactly what I did. So I would go to a trailer park, and if anyone talked to me, and I said, hey, listen, I'm looking for Esperanza Vasquez. Do you know her? No. Well, does she owe you money? Is she messing with your man? What is it you know is, I write books, and I know she has an interesting story. And they would say, like, oh, you're looking for a story. It's really the right place. And she would tell me her story. And we would be in the trailer park, and someone just walked by. Hey, what are you guys doing? Oh, this woman writes a book, and she wants stories. Come to my trailer after you finish. I'll tell you mine. And what happens is, by the time I got to the following trailer park, I already had 5 wonderful stories. And I didn't set out to write a book. I just wanted to find her. I didn't write a book. I didn't want to write a book. I just wanted to see her. I just wanted to find her. There was nothing else there. And the harder I look for her, the more stories I have. And then I would go home and just look at all the interviews, and I said, there are lots of commonalities. There is a lot of history, a lot of emotion, a lot of blood and tears and grit and hope. It was just very moving to see all this collection of humanity here, and what it meant to be a mother, a woman, what it meant to be hungry and ignored and voiceless. And it was just so much abandonment in their voices that I started to think, I think I have something here. I think I can do something with this. And the thing that I thought I could do was to give them voice. I cannot change their lives, I cannot do an immigration reform, I cannot change the way things are, but I can give them voice, and that's what I try to do in looking for Esperanza.
Yeah, but what do you think, what was your responsibility to the women that you interviewed? Like, did you, in terms of your follow-up with them, so for many of the women in the book, it seemed like you developed a relationship with them where you would visit them many times, and you know, I don't know, like, did you keep in contact with them? Did you show them the product at the end? Like, what did you think, and if you were, if any of us were going to maybe do something like this, like, what do you think the responsibility, the moral or ethical responsibility is? Like, should we show them the product? Should we go in with a, this is my end game, and hopefully there'll be a product at the end of this, or,
okay. So anthropologists, just like journalists, they need people's consent to polish the story, right? And that is the first hurdle, because they are hiding from the law. So they don't want the names, they don't want the pictures taken, they don't want the addresses written down. So they're very, and rightfully so, they're very suspicious about people making inquiries about their lives. But once you get over that, once they say, I'll tell you my story, but don't put my name down, or do not identify me, do not take pictures, or whatever. Once you have that and you develop a rapport, and if that rapport happens to become friendship, that's easy. That's easy, because and then you just go with your heart, right? You can put professional guidelines aside and just go and you visit a friend. The problem lies for me is when you are not friends and when they are the subjects of your investigation. So you have to be very careful about not crossing boundaries, you know, and there are guidelines in anthropology, just like in journalism, that you're not supposed to pay your subject for information, right? The information has to be given to you freely. You're not supposed to reward, but if you go and interview a woman that is hungry, the least you can do is offer an enchilada in exchange for information, right? And I broke the guideline gladly, and I would do it all over again when I went to the fields to work with them. I didn't want to give them money, first of all, because I didn't have any, and second, because it's just not right. It's not ethical right to pay cash for information. But what I thought I could do is just, in the process of working with them, going to the fields with them, I could learn, I could experience in my own skin and body the pain that they had to endure when they worked on the fields, and at the same time, I could give them something in exchange. And that was that all the tokens that the farmer gave me for my work would go to them, right? It's not completely ethical, but I'm happy with that. I'm happy with being unethical like that. Now, here's the other thing, is that I conducted all the interviews in Spanish because they don't speak English, right? And would you like to see the book when it comes out? Yeah, whatever. Well, that was 2 years down the road. And I had almost to start the process all over, like looking for Esperanza and Maria and Laura, because I don't know where they are anymore. They're scattered, they moved. Some of them have been deported. Some could be dead. I have to go back and look for them again all over, up and down the peninsula with my books, right? Feeling this commitment, like this was part of the deal. I told you that you would have the result in your hands, and I found three of them. And if you go to my website, which is a little bit neglected, if you go to Looking for Esperanza, you will see the pictures of the women with the book, right? Three of them. And I remember the first one that I found, they said, do you remember me? A few, the one with the nosy one, the one with the crazy question. And I said, well, here's the book. And she goes, in English. And it dawned on me, what a stupid woman I was. It had not crossed my mind that what I owe was a book in Spanish that I could read and relish and say, that's me, that's my story. They couldn't do that. And in all those years, between the investigation and the interviewing and the reporting and the publishing, never crossed my mind to have the book in Spanish for them. But it was too late, and it was just a shortcoming. It's just the way it is. That's what happened. And I found three of them. Laura's husband speaks English, so he read the book to her. And that was really cool. Carlitos' mom doesn't speak English, and she was the one that I was very interested in finding, because I wanted to see Carlitos again. I wanted to see how he was doing, and I wanted, because I'm nosy like that, I just wanted to find out the result of the trial, the lawsuit, right? And I found them. I went looking for them. It was very difficult to find. They were very difficult to find. And they're living in this grandiose house, a cul-de-sac. Two Dodge Ram trucks parked in the driveway. I'm thinking, I guess that's my answer. That's my answer right here. They invited me in. The house was amazing. I mean, this granite, the kitchen I had was like this aisle of granite that went on forever. So nice. Your house is so nice. It was a beautiful, beautiful house. Carlitos was, probably 11. And he had grown, funny enough, I mean, the little torso that he had, it had grown. So he was a bigger kid, and then the head had grown too, so you could tell that he was no longer the little baby that I had met. Had state-of-the-art wheelchair with all the gadgets and the whistles and everything. I mean, just he's just moving it with his mouth and just going around the house, and it was just so beautiful to see that he was not the little Carlitos with those contraptions, you know. Just no, I mean, he had technology. Some people had come to the aid and they say, we see potential, we did you wrong, here it is, go live the rest of your life with whatever we can give you.
Did he speak English?
Yeah, yes he did. He said, you want to be my girlfriend? No, I don't want to be your girlfriend. So, yeah, that's the answer to your question. Did I answer?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, all right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you find it, it's hard to separate your own personal compassion and feeling for your subjects when you have to go into a professional setting? Or do you not tend to go into that boundary because you're just appreciation for your human being overrides some of the protocols?
It's such a dangerous field. This is what happened in Kuwait, and I'm going to answer to that question with a story, because I am a storyteller, right? When I went into the work camp to work with Indian women in Kuwait, I already knew the result of the research. I already knew it. Okay, I knew that they were neglected, I knew that they were exploited, I knew that they fell under the category of modern slaves. I knew they were voiceless and all these things. I knew that. So my job was easy. All I had to do was go and corroborate my suspicions. You know, I have preconceived ideas. All I had to do is go spend 2 years with them and check the boxes. Yep, I was right. I knew this, I knew that. And the results were devastating because they did not match my preconceptions. Mm-hmm. For instance, I saw them as exploited, neglected, and pretty much in a bad shape. And they were very proud of being in Kuwait, because for them to be in Kuwait put them way above the hierarchy that they otherwise would have been in India. I saw the gender segregation as a hindrance for, you know, development of sexual relations or anything. They had no contact with men for 2 years. And I thought, how crazy is that? These women are young, they're beautiful, they're strong, and they don't have companionship because of this gender segregation rule here. Right? That's terrible. And they're like, oh, thank goodness we don't have men here. It is fantastic. No one beats us up, no one gets us pregnant, no one abuses us. This is great, right? How about air conditioning systems? We don't like air conditioning systems. We don't need these units. They're noisy. Lucy. He was nice. We like that that's India. And I just came back from spending 45 days in India. I was in an ashram. And I was reflecting all this. I'm living with Indians, eating what Indians eat, living the Indian life in the Himalayas, and it's 99% humidity. You can hardly breathe because the air is just so humid and so heavy. And no one is using ACs. We just have a malfunctioning fan, and that's plenty for everyone. They felt very privileged to be in Kuwait because many of them were Irava in India, they're untouchables. The caste system disappears when they leave India, so they felt liberated. Mm-hmm. No more caste system, they were all equal. How wrong was I? I had gone there to say, I already know the answer to all my questions. All I had to do was ask a few questions and hang out with them, observe and check the boxes. And I had to start all over. It is hard. It is hard when you start studying a culture or a subculture not to walk in with preconceived notions. I don't know how to do it. You already have an idea. You already have preconceived ideas of what you're going to find. I don't know how to do it otherwise. You just have to go and admit when you have crossed that line, right? And go back, take a step back, start all over.
What did you do about pesticide exposure? I mean, you were in the fields with the pesticides with people. Did you get a checkup? Did you take something to prevent? I mean,
there wasn't any irrigation the times that I went out with them. No. No, I was not exposed, and actually it never crossed my mind.
So I had thought about doing something, working with apple pickers to do an article for a season, and then I looked at the contract which said you'll be exposed to this and this and this and this, and I said, well, yeah, about something else.
Yeah, okay, that's interesting. No, it never crossed my mind to check, but I was never, exposed to any chemicals.
Now, along those lines, what were you ever worried about your safety in those kind of ghetto areas?
No.
With that nice truck, or I don't know if it was nice.
No, not really. I felt a little bit aware of certain difficulties when I would go to a woman's trailer park and say, you need to leave before 5 because Francisco comes at 5 and he doesn't want me to spill my beans to him. I don't want him to know that I'm talking to strangers. Mm-hmm. Or the day I walked into the trailer park and this woman's sister had a black eye, mm-hmm. and I knew the guy was there. And I couldn't do anything, but I knew there was violence, and it was palpable, and it was just part of the culture. They all got beat up by their husbands, and it was just like having a cold. Sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't. It's just the way it is. It's just the way it is. But no, my personal safety. And I think the fact that I am Latina, and that I look like them, that kind of just creates a sense of safety. It's different, I would imagine, I would imagine that it would be different if you are white, blue-eyed, blonde, walking into a group of undocumented Mexicans. Maybe it would be different because you would be perceived as odd and what does you want. But once I was there, I was just one of them, so there was no mystery. But I was aware of some violent men in where I was, without feeling afraid, I was aware that they were around.
Yeah, but can you talk about when it came time to put the book together, the inclusion of the chapters that aren't the women's stories themselves, mm-hmm. so the letter to your mother and the second person essay, the wetbacks are coming. Can you talk about why they were important for you to include? Mm.
I wrote my mother's funeral first. That was my first book, but it wasn't published. And I was working on looking for Esperanza when my mother died. And it was just a very conflicting time for me. I didn't have the energy to honor these women when I felt that I should be honoring my mom. So I just kind of wanted to channel everything, all my energy, I just wanted to pay tribute to my mom, and I had nothing left for the women. I just went dry. I just wanted to sit and mourn. And in the process of mourning, I wanted to include my mom in the story. You know, how wonderful it would be if rather than compartmentalizing my mourning and my tribute pain, how about if I could just make a package and make my mom part of it? And I had written a letter to my mom, which I never finished. But we had this conversation over the phone because she thought it was the most ridiculous thing that I would spend so much money chasing a woman that she was sure didn't want to talk to me. Right? And the reason she was so certain that Esperanza would not talk to me is because they have secrets and things that are put in the back. We were talking about it yesterday. Mm-hmm. All the things that our mothers don't tell us because mm-hmm. they belong in the past and they're not willing to reveal that. It's like we move on. And my mom understood that. And that put her so close to Esperanza somehow. We move on, mija, forget about it. Just don't go out, you know, waking up ghosts. It's all in the past. And so the letter came, right? I had a literary agent, and she was very well respected, and I was over the moon that she would even look at me. Her name was Anne Hawkins, and she worked for J.H. Hawkins Agency, which is the oldest literary agency in New York. She has this huge hit a few years ago. It was Ronald Reagan's biography, mm-hmm. and it was a bestseller. I still won. And she just looked at a little me and said, I'm interested in your work. And I was like, my God, this is fantastic, right? So I wrote the thing, I gave it to her, and she had it for about 4 years. Mm-hmm. Oh. 4 years during which I didn't get any feedback. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Every time she got a rejection letter or it was a close call, Adriana such and such say that it was really good, but they just published Enrique's Journey. Mm-hmm. This is really good, but they just did a documentary, blah, blah. It just never happened, but I never knew why it wasn't selling. Because she's not a writer herself. Mm-hmm. She's a saleswoman. So what she does is she grabs a product and she sells it well, right? But she's not a writer, so she never went through the manuscript and said, okay, this is not working, you need tweaking here, modifying there. I never get that. But one of the things that she told me, and this is the things that I shared with you in the workshop, is that the question that you need to ask is, how do I make my book stand out? Because if you look for justice memoirs, social justice memoirs, there are thousands of them. And the only way your book is going to sell is if you make it different. And that is when I decided that maybe these interviews, the way they were initially, were not going to work. That they needed to be interspersed, and I needed more meat in between. So the idea of the abecedarium was good. I think it works as a literary device because it allowed me to jump. So I do a little bit of jumping, but you get the idea. Because every paragraph gives you an idea of a different aspect of the subculture that I was working with. The letter to my mom, I just used the letter that I initially wrote and finished the letter with the bits of conversations that we had over the phone. The wetbacks are coming. It just came to me like an epiphany. It was pretty much one day I just had this vision of them coming out of the river with gills, you know, just coming wet and just kind of shaking their gills and getting rid of the water. And it was just almost an image that just came, and I just wrote with it. And I just wrote it just one afternoon, and I never went back, I never revised, never edited. It is the way I wrote it that afternoon. And what I did is just, I didn't want to have a continuum of interviews. I just wanted to have a little bit of music, just to have a little bit of a rhythm to the reading so it didn't become too thick, too dense, too heavy. And that's how we ended up with the way the book is organized. Yeah, did I answer your question?
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit more about the decisions you made about what information to include about Esperanza? You mentioned that there was those details that you didn't include because they weren't relevant. So how did you decide that they weren't relevant? Because they were going to make the reader lose sympathy for her or distract from the story of her journey? What went into that decision?
So when you write about social justice, you make lots of ethical decisions. Because you have to decide what information goes into the book and what you leave out. And that is ethical. You choose the tone of the book first, right? You decide what kind of tone your book is going to have. Is it going to be an expose? Do you want to teach? Do you want to compel? Do you want to move? Is it just a collection of stories? Once you decide what you want to do, you start eliminating. So you associate. See, all, let's say I have 120 stories. 25 stories are about losing a baby, so I can do just one of them. The one that represents the widest scope of the journey. So I choose that interview and eliminate the other 24, not because they are not relevant, but because I don't have the space for 25 women losing their babies in a book. So I choose the one that is the widest in scope, and that's the one that goes, the other 24 just feed information but do not make it to the book. So you make associations and choose one that represents the biggest scope of that circle here, right? So you choose the voice, you choose the kind of sentiment that you want to arouse, and then you choose and group the stories, and then you just put it all together and see. It's not important for the reader that Esperanza is an alcoholic. I'm talking about a woman making a journey from A to B on foot and losing a baby in the journey. Whether or not she drinks is irrelevant, right?
Did you change her being an alcoholic to her being sick?
No, she was sick.
She was sick.
Yeah. The day I found her, she had a broken femur. Yeah, no, nothing was changed. Nothing was changed. It was omitted intentionally. Just because it didn't help the narrative, it didn't help the tone. But you have to make lots of little ethical decisions like that. Yeah. Did I answer your question? Yeah? Yeah.
You mentioned that you hadn't set out to write a book when you started seeking out these women and looking for Esperanza. At what point did you make the decision, and what was sort of the approach? I mean, I guess you had the notes, obviously, because you're an anthropologist, so you were writing things down, but what did that process look like of then turning it into a book for you?
It's pretty much the way I said earlier. It was this just feeling every time I got home, and let's say I had 5 interviews in one day, and I would be at home just taking a look, and I said, God, just so much. There's so much here. I mean, I can't believe this woman has crossed the border 32 times. Mm-hmm. I can't believe she swam, she crawled, she jumped, she did everything. I mean, it's like an athlete. It was just fantastic. She'd be like the Border Olympics. 101 ways to make it to the USA. Very creative. It was just the amount and the heft of the stories that compelled me to write it. I could not just put it aside and say, well, that's not Esperanza. I think it was just a call, and I think it was the connection for being a woman. Mm-hmm. I think had it been a man, I don't think this would have translated into a book. I don't think the urgency would have been as heavy and as compelling as it was, knowing that they were women, mother, immigrants, me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there was just a more visceral connection to the women that was hearing, that they were just sharing their lives and their journeys and their dramas with me. Yeah, I think it was just here, just something very visceral that compelled me to put everything together. Yeah.
Something tells me Griselda didn't want a copy of the book.
She just wanted money.
I know.
But see, she doesn't help the cause. But I think she's important because she's the grit.
Yeah.
Not everything is, you know, it's, I want the American dream for my kids. No, I mean, she wants money. and I think that her presence in the book is important because
Yeah.
It's realistic. I mean, it's a real woman, and she'll get her penny in any way she can.
So the story goes that when Abraham Lincoln met Harriet Beecher Stowe, he said, "So here's the woman that started the war," from Uncle Tom's Cabin. And so my question to you is, are you doing anything to market your book to increase the popularity so that perhaps the next person who might end up in on this would read that book and have a different perspective on the current narrative?
Okay. No, Benno Press is a very small press. I have visions of this guy printing the books in his garage. I mean, the guy just somewhere there, just doing it. It's a very small press. They are fantastic in as much as they publish social justice books. And I really admire that. And I know he doesn't make a lot of money, and he keeps publishing these books every year. But there was no money, no budget for promotion from the beginning. When the book was published and it won a few awards and got little bits of, you know, some accolades, I was called to do a reading in New York, to two different places. It was probably like 3 months after the book was published, and it was huge. It was a big moment for me as a writer because I had never read anything in public. And God bless the baristas because they were the only ones in the place. Right? And I say that, and it's very humbling, because when you write a book, you think everyone is crazy about it, and when you do a reading, you have these visions of like, you know, like if they can do the wave and everything. It's a very humbling process. Nobody was there, just the baristas. And I'm just there waiting for anyone to show up. And with a big smile and being very gracious and thinking inside. A few people walked in for coffee, and the baristas were kind enough to say, coffee is on the house if you stay for the meeting. So they stayed, and that's fine, because that's part of being a writer. That was my promotion. That's how I promoted the book. And the other reason didn't go any better. It's just now that I know what I know, I realize how foolish it was to pretend to have a full house in New York when nobody knew me. Yeah, New York is the huge ocean and I am a little tadpole. It just doesn't work. You know, when you're a tadpole, you just choose a little tank, and that's where you're big. Right? And I just,
yeah, exactly.
So, no, there is no promotion. I just word of mouth and the hope that you tell your family and your neighbors and that we read the book, and if we can't afford the book, then we share the book, so more of us become aware, and we do something. And if we don't do something, that's good too, because part of the process is to bring awareness. You are aware. You choose not to do nothing, that's all right. You want to do something, good. But half of my job is to make you aware. So whether or not you choose action, that's up to you. But as long as you're aware, I'm happy. So let's share the book.
When it was in its initial stages, did you ever think about possibly doing it as a journalistic piece, like a feature of some sort? Or was it always going to be a memoir from the onset?
No.
Or like in serial pieces or something?
No. See, this little thing that I read in the newspaper was part of a long... I don't know what you call it, like a documentary in the newspaper. It was from the Palm Beach Post. And John Lantigua was the journalist that interviewed Esperanza, and he was instrumental in the, you know, in the writing of the book. John Lantigua, you can look him up. Now he writes true crime. So he's a journalist based in Miami, and he is there all the time, you know, documenting crimes and writing fantastic novels about all the gore in Miami. But from the beginning, it was a memoir. How are we doing for time? We good? Yeah? Any question? Now, the question that I have for you, did we see the intersection of the three things? Did we see how many times in what we do, journalism, anthropology, and memoir intersect? Yeah. Did we see that? Because that's the point of being here. Cool. It's all good? Yeah?